Hello everyone, I am Dr. Prashna Samadhar. The present subject which has been dealt in this particular presentation is the immigration law, and the topic which I am going to cover is Assam Accord. The basic objectives which have been targeted in this particular presentation are to understand the background of Assam, the history of Assam, to discuss the infiltration trend in Assam, to analyze the immigration trend in Assam, and to understand the implication of Citizenship Amendment Act in terms of Assam population is concerned. Now, in this particular slide, I would like to start with the political geographical location of Assam. You can see the political map of Assam. Now, it is very important to understand that the position of Assam in the entire map of India plays a very pivotal role with the special status Assam has received over the period of time in terms of immigration is concerned. So, you can see well enough that this particular place, the entire coming from West Bengal, this entire particular border, this entire particular border is still this is all Bangladesh. This is entire Bangladesh. So you can see what is the nature of the territory which has been covered by Bangladesh at all. So this is the entire place where Bangladesh and India shares a border, and the border has been shared by none other than the state of Assam. Now, one more thing which becomes very very questionable is that West Bengal also shares one of the major, because here, starting from here till the end, there is West Bengal. So there may a question may arise that why then West Bengal has not got the same status but Assam has got, and why people have chose Assam over West Bengal to get a safe haven. There are many reasons for that. Firstly, the positionality. The entire border which I have highlighted here over here is a porous border, which is thick, dense forest. Okay, with some marshy rivers, with some deep rivers and all of that. So the geographical challenges over here makes us pose a great limitation for the Indian armed forces to be posted there on a regular basis. Although India has taken very considerate effort to post Indian Army over there, BSF over there, so that the border may get protected. But in spite of that, there are certain human limitations. You can't stay over that place where, which is a dense forest, and where livelihood or getting your living conditions becomes a great task. So you cannot stay there for a long period of time. You can send task force there for residing there and sending all the fodder and everything, livestock basically, is a big challenge over there. So this is one of the big reason. Now you can say that why posting is a challenge, but then why not crossing? Now if you want to say that if it's a case that wherever you are staying is your regular life, wherever you are staying regularly is not safe. And if you come to know that there is some other place which is neighboring to your place where you can go and stay safely, but the path is somewhat rigorous, you would obviously choose that rigorous path to get to that safe haven. So that's what has happened, that there have been plenty of reasons which Bangladesh has given from time to time to their individuals, to their subjects, so that they have crossed Indo-Bangla border and they have come over in Assam. Now, during that time, Assam this was the first reason. Now, second reason is that if the question comes that if Bangladesh also shares a big border, a wide border with West Bengal, but then why infiltration is not so very rampant in West Bengal, but in Assam it is rampant? The answer is very, very simple, that Bangladesh got partitioned from West Bengal. So there have been people who had to leave their entire property, their family, their roots. They have to uproot themselves who were residing there from ages. They have to uproot themselves from those territory, and they have to go back to Bangladesh. Now, if now they are given chance to go back to their own place, there are many people who will not opt for that because they don't want to recollect those remorses. In comparison to that, they know that Assam is a bit peaceful place, is a bit peaceful state. So they will choose West, Assam over West Bengal to go and take a safe refuge. Okay, so this is the second reason. Third reason is that the culture and the tradition. Those people who stay in this part of the Bangladesh, their cultural practices or their languages or the way of life is somewhat similar to those people who are staying in the state of Assam. So basically they feel much more homely, much more coagulated, much more at ease to go and reside in Assam rather than to go to some other place like in Tripura. Or also Tripura is also a prey to such kind of infiltration, but obviously you can see the border of the Tripura, the comparison is nowhere. The extent of the border which Bangladesh shares with Tripura and the extent which it shares with Assam, there's no comparison. So of course, although Tripura has also been a place of choice for people to infiltrate, Assam is comparatively, the infiltration in Assam is comparatively much, much higher. Okay, so these are some of the facts because of which infiltration in Assam has been chosen over any other state with which Bangladesh shares its borders. Now here, as I was discussing in the previous slide, here you can see the entire jurisdiction, the entire international border of Bangladesh is highlighted here with this orange color. And I am highlighting again this with the yellow color. So you can see, I have said earlier also that a very well founded question may come in anybody's mind that how, in spite of the fact that West Bengal shares a bigger border than that of Assam, West Bengal is not under the discussion as Assam has been, or West Bengal has not faced those issues as Assam has faced. So, and another issue which I have So the 3 to 4 issues I have already said in the previous slide. Another issue is that if you go to Assam, after entering into Assam, the entire northeast is there, and the entire northeast is away from the central control. In spite of the fact that it is due to its positionality, that nothing can be done. In regard to that, in obviously they are bearing the brunt, the entire seven states are bearing the brunt due to their positionality, because they are so much away from the center that many a times it happens that if you are out of sight, you are out of mind also. In spite of the fact that there are many people, many ministers who are there, who are representing Northeast in the Indian Parliament, but in spite of the fact, the number is, if you get the proportionality, it is very low in number. So basically, once a person enter into Assam, the person has an option to settle in any of the state, whether it is Arunachal Pradesh, which was NEFA previously, and whether or Nagaland or Manipur or Mizoram or Tripura. Okay, so these are all the options available to that person, and all of these states are normally peaceful states in spite of obviously they have internal issues, and the internal issues has cropped up because of this unabated infiltration. And this unabated infiltration was for a long period of time avoided or overlooked by the central government. The central government was knowing that there has been in episodes of infiltration, repeated infiltration are happening. Whenever issues have cropped up in Bangladesh, whether it is 1971, when Bangladesh got liberated as Bangladesh from East Pakistan, it became Bangladesh. Then again, later on, when something called... their citizenship laws were getting amended, and those people who were Hindus, Hindu Bihari community, they were getting stripped of their citizenship rights. Then again, infiltration has happened. Again, when CHT, Chittagong Hill Tract people were forced to relocate themselves because they were erecting a particular dam over there. So it is called as development induced infiltration. So then again, also infiltration has happened in Assam. So all of these repeated episodes of infiltration were happening in Assam in lots, in you can say in installments. And these installments and these infiltrations were really felt out by the Indian government, but they for a long time overlooked it, considering it as not a serious issue. But it was a serious issue. It is a serious issue indeed. Now, there is a long history of immigration in Assam. It's not that only post-independence it has happened. It was prior to independence also that Assam is a coagulation of infiltrated population only, because it was previously, prior to, during the colonial period, in Assam was basically a tea dominated state, where the tea plantations are, is dominating economy. So there what used to happen is they used to share their shares border with Myanmar. So during that time, some of the population, when Assam, when the Raja of Ahom, which is known as Ahom Raja, when they used to do this tea gardening, they used to hire people from Myanmar state. And that time borders, international borders, were not so seriously treated. So people from the, because Myanmar population also, there are a lot of people who are Hindus or who are Muslims, but share some common type of culture, like Rohingya people. They share some common type of culture. They share some common type of language. So they used to come over here and take some appointment and take some job and used to work in those tea gardens. Now, there were no such territory or there was no such border which was declared between Assam and Myanmar. But post British's control over Assam or in the entire dominion of India, they wanted to settle down with the international border. They wanted to settle that, they wanted to settle this issue that there must be an international border which differentiates Myanmar and Assam. So with this particular consideration in their mind, they entered into an Ian Babu Treaty. And this treaty is, although not here mentioned, but this treaty plays a pivotal role. With this treaty, Myanmar, the international demarcation of Assam, which is still continuing, of Assam and Myanmar was decided. Okay. And then it was said that by then, the infiltration was, it was not considered as infiltration. People from Myanmar were settling in Assam and were taking their day-to-day livelihood from Assam itself. But when international border got declared, then the people who were settled in Assam, but were belonging to Myanmar, had to decide that whether now, because now it has become an international border, traveling from Assam to Myanmar or to and fro becomes not so easy. Okay, although it was a British dominion, although it was a British government which was taking care of all of this, but of course it was not so easy as it was before. So that is how the infiltration started happening. Those people who for ages were staying there, they started taking a serious decision of relocating themselves from Myanmar to Assam. So that is how the infiltration has happened in those days. And after that also, in many conditions, infiltrations has happened. Immigrate Hindus from Nepal, Bhutan have also migrated to Assam in many times. From Bhutan also, there is a community called Loth Shampa who have been persecuted on religious minority basis. So they also, many of the population from Loth Shampas who are Hindu Nepalese, they also came over in Assam and settled down in various districts of Assam. So Assam has a long run, deep-seated history of immigration. It's not that only post-independence. India, Assam, and just because after the creation of Bangladesh, Assam has faced immigration. Immigration has happened in Assam from ages. But the point is that those ages, when after Ian Babu Treaty, you may say infiltration has happened or all of that, that was not disputed by the aboriginal people of Assam. The aboriginal people of Assam, that is the Ahom, people from Ahom community, they didn't object it to those infiltrations. They started objecting to those infiltrations which started happening after independence and specifically after 1971. When they saw that their religion, their culture, their people, their ethnicity is getting marginalized. And people from different states different countries are coming to their state and getting settled without any question. Without any prohibition, it's an unabated infiltration. So they obviously it was a fear in their mind that their culture, their ethnicity, their aboriginality, their identity as a different class, as a different community is getting marginalized very badly. So that was the reason because of which they started objecting to those infiltration. It was not the previous or the prior primary infiltration which was a bone of contention from them. It was the later on migrations, immigrations, which started happening in as a bone of contention for them. And later on they started shaping different movements to stop those kind of infiltrations. So now, because this, as I said, that there are various fear which started cropping up in their mind regarding the infiltration and regarding marginalization of their own aboriginality, they came up that the concern was taken to the Union government, and Union government also found it true enough that your identity and your ethnicity can't be snatched. So that is how the concept of Assam Accord started taking shape. There was Assam Gana Parishad, so Assam ASU movement was that, student union movement was there, Assam Asimilita Student Sangathan, that is ASU, was there, and this ASU was resulted into Assam Accord in 1985. I mean, obviously not ASU, but the political front of the ASU group, they started communicating their threat or the fear they have over their head. They started communicating the same to the Union government, and Union government at the same time also given importance to that particular concept, and they said that okay, fine, we can sign up to a understanding whereby we will keep a cutoff date. And then this cutoff date would be considered as the last date of immigration or legal immigration in India. After that, whoever has immigrated in India would be considered, especially in the territory of Assam, would be considered as an illegal infiltrator. And the person concerned has to prove that you are not, the person concerned is not an illegal infiltrator by providing all those requisite travel documents which is required for a legal immigration. So in case, the entire burden of the proof would be on the person to treat. But Assam Accord again has said that if anybody or if the state itself wants to take any step for ousting any person as an illegal immigrant, okay, then of course you have to, the state has the first right to prove that you are an illegal immigrant. The burden of proving that you are an illegal immigrant resides primarily on the state. Obviously, then you have to prove that you are an illegal immigrant or not. But the first responsibility lies on the state to, or the concerned party who have come up with the a complaint that a concerned person is an illegal immigrant, the burden lies over that person or the state to prove that you are an illegal immigrant. Okay, so these are the ASU movement, Bhasha Andolan and all of that, as I have said, the fear of the getting snatched away from their own territory, from their own originality, their culture, their assimilation, their originality, their aboriginality. Anybody will have a fear of that. If you can see that all your villages are getting filled up by people from community outside your community. So that is how it's shaped the ASU movement. Now, these are some of the datas which I have found from one of a very good presentation of SlideShare. I refer to those presentation in my references also. I found this to be very, very relevant in terms of showing that whether immigration is a myth or reality in terms of Assam is concerned. Because there were various political thinkers, politicians or sociologists who have criticized that position of Assam, because Assam has a bit of sensitive positioning, because of that people of Assam have took it as a political issue and want to be highlighted as one of the most prominent state of Northeast, because they have the widest land or widest jurisdiction premises in Northeast. So other states are also there. Why they are not taking this plea? But Assam is only taking this plea. But that is not the case always. Assam has actually been the scapegoat of immigration, and this particular table shows the reality. So this again, there are various districts which I have tried to highlight, which the presentation itself has tried to highlight, and I have referred to the same in this presentation because it seems to be very, very apt to be discussed over here. So there are different districts which I have tried to highlight, Kokrajhar, Dhubri, Bongao, Borpeta. These are some of the prominent districts of Assam. And in the tehsil, religion-wise differences have been shown to show that what was the Hindu population, the aboriginal population, what was the Muslim population in the year 1991 and in the year 2001. So in a gap of 10 years, what is the growth rate of the population in terms of the community and religion is concerned. So the growth rate we can see of the aboriginal population and the growth rate of the infiltrators or the immigrants. The immigrants' growth rate is much higher than that of the aboriginal growth rate population in this entire decade of 1991 to till 2001. This is something which is very surprising fact, and at the same time it's a very interesting fact to show that it's not a myth entirely that Assam is just because of their own positionality making it as a political fuss. It's not that. You can see here it's written that shown that overall growth rate of Assam 16.9% is lower than national average 17.8% in 2001 to 11 decade. But when districts like Dhubri 24.4%, Nogaon 22.9%, Borpeta 22.9%, Darang 21%, all districts have above national average. This average total tribal districts like Kokrajhar, Chirang, Nalbari are ones below the national average. So this average is the growth rate of the aboriginal population, and if we can see the aboriginal population growth in Assam is very very low in terms of in comparison to the other states of India. Okay, so at the end of this particular presentation, the questions which may come up in somebody's mind is what is the geographical positioning of Assam, what is Assam Accord, what is the historical background of Assam infiltration, and what is the reality of infiltration in Assam. So these are some of the facts, and we have to remember one thing that these are human incidences. So, and the way in which you look the human incidences vary from one eye to the other. So there is no political affiliations to which I belong to, but there are certain things which are actual happening. So we need to understand the actual happenings because we are law students. There is no biasness is allowed for a law student to understand the entire concept. Okay, hope you have enjoyed this presentation. Hope to see you in my next presentation. Again, thank you so much for such a patient hearing. Thank you.